Hello, everyone, and welcome back to the Commander Clash podcast, where we talk all things Commander. And today we're going to talk about the best cards to use to stay alive, and we're going to rank them according to their categories. So things like counterspell, things like spot removal, like Swords to Plowshares, sweepers, etc. We're going to see what some of the best cards you can use are to stay alive and make sure you're in the game to actually win it when it matters. So joining with me today is Seth, probably better known as Saffron Olive. How are you doing?
I'm doing good. I'm excited for this one. I like staying alive, so this is the perfect topic for me.
Tomer, budget commander, how do you feel about staying alive?
I need to learn. This is going to be really helpful for me to learn how to stay alive.
Krim, the Asian Avenger, how are you doing?
All my decks do is try to stay alive. They don't try to win. They just try to stay alive.
If you're not losing, you're winning, right? Isn't that the expression?
True.
Is that how it goes?
I think that's how that works, yeah.
Wait, trying to live or trying to troll? Because I feel like there's...
I mean,
you can't
are you
troll
living?
If you're dead.
Same thing.
Yeah. Some would say I do the most living, so...
I'm your host, Richard, and we're going to delve into the best cards to stay alive today. But before we do that, our show is brought to you by Card Conduit, the easiest way to sell your Magic cards. So Card Conduit lets you skip all the typing, time, and work associated with buy listing. Their curated service lets you send in as many cards as you want with buy list value one or more, and you'll pay just a 5% service fee. You can use their sorted service where you list and sort your cards and only pay 2%. You get a detailed report and fast payment once your order is processed. You can get 10% off by heading over to cardconduit.com/mtggoldfish. So thank you, Card Conduit, for supporting today's show. And we'll jump straight into the best cards to stay alive. So we have a tier list up. We will choose a representative card, but we're not ranking the cards per se. We're ranking the categories. So the first category, we're going to start off with a softball. Okay, we're going to start off with just catch-all protection. Things that say, like, you cannot die. So, like, Teferi's Protection, the One Ring. You know, Teferi's Protection phases you out. You know, your life total can't change. All your permanents are gone. You protect everything in one shot. The ring says you get protection from everything. Across the board, everyone gave it an S.
Surprise.
Yep.
I mean,
is this the best form of protection, like, ever?
Yeah.
The card literally says, don't die. So, yes.
I mean, they say, always have protection. And that's true here. So...
It's really just Teferi's Protection, right? Like, in this entire category? Like, is there anything else that even is in this category? Okay, that is not.
The One Ring.
The One Ring is, like, way worse than Teferi's Protection.
Angel's Grace? It prevents you from losing? Or your life reducing from one for one turn?
Yep.
Does Plat Angel count as that?
I think
technically.
The main reason Teferi's Protection is just so much like above all these other ones is not only is it like the best at being like you can't die because Angel's Grace, if your opponent's like combo off, then that stops that. But if it prevents you from losing, you're at like a one, so that's kind of tough. But this one is the only one that's like. You don't die, and also, by the way, you can just use it like to just stop a board wipe. You know, make the board wipe hurt all your opponents except you. Like the versatility of this is so good.
Yeah, which means like your opponent spends their turn, kind of like essentially their whole turn, and just doing the board wipe action while you benefit, right?
Yeah.
But do things like March of Swirling Mists and Clever Concealment count as that?
I mean, they aren't keeping you alive, right?
Yeah,
like we're talking about keeping you alive today. So I would say not for today, because it's just saving your creatures rather than saving your life total. I guess March could phase out opposing creatures, so maybe in the fog tier, you could like try to phase out your opponent's stuff.
Whoa! It's better than fog. Okay, it's better.
Yeah,
than
you
fog.
You could actually blank an attack with this.
Yeah, it counts as a fog, but like Teferi's Protection is just so much stronger because if someone tries to burn you, like March's Swirling Mist doesn't help.
It's
not foolproof, right? Because if someone has a I win the game card, you still lose if you're phased out. You just can't take damage and things like that. And I think, are there weird scenarios with like infect or commander damage? Can you somehow get, there's like some weird edge cases of getting around Teferi's Protection.
What's the edge case?
Yes. So you can actually kill them with infect damage and commander damage, stuff that like puts a lethal counter on the person basically, because your life total can't change. But like infect and stuff, putting poison counters does not change your life total per se. Being protection from everything, if you use like an effect that says damage can't be prevented this turn, then you hit your somebody for like 21 commander damage. The person's life total cannot change, but the commander damage will still be tacked on. And so that's a way to kill them. Also poison counters with infect, for example, is actually a way of getting around it. But like it's... how many times have we ever seen that happen? Like, I've seen so many Teferi's Protection because it's like one of the most popular cards. I've seen so many Teferi's Protection just save the day a billion different times, and I've never seen somebody be like, aha, gotcha, actually.
I have a question for you guys real quick, but if you're going to move on. Like, do you play anything outside of Teferi's Protection in this class? Because I feel like for me, Teferi's Protection's an auto-include. The One Ring's an auto-include, but that's because it draws a lot of cards. The protection's kind of like a bonus and not that good. It's like, okay.
Like a Lupus.
But there's,
we've seen that.
Yeah. But even that, like, protection from everything, you still get drained out. There's still a lot of things that can get you through One Ring Protection, way more so than Teferi's Protection. But I'm curious, like, you don't play Angel's Grace, right? Or Platinum Angel,
I've tried Angel Grace for a while. I've concluded it's not good.
Not worth it.
It's super situational, and like Tomer said, even if you get it to go off, like, you're at one, so you need a way to win the game when you untap or like life gain your way back. So I don't think playing Angel's Grace as a second Teferi's pro is that good, but it does lead to a lot of like gotcha moments, right? I think Teferi's Protection is so far above everything else that you just play it. Like, the question is, if they have a like one mana instant that's like you gain protection from everything this turn, would you play that? Like, that would be a more interesting one, which I think Wizards will eventually print. But right now, kind of, it's by its own.
Yeah, that makes sense. That's basically where I'm at, I think.
Pro is definitely
it's
a go. Its own
we
league.
Have to get it out of the way.
And it's good. It's good, right? So this is what we're comparing everything to. Okay, let's move on to something saucy immediately. Specific spot removal. Okay, so what is specific spot removal? Swords to Plowshares is kind of the poster child. So it is something that removes something very efficiently, but a single class as well. So, for example, this is in contrast to Generous Gift, which is 3 mana to remove anything. Swords of Plowshares is 1 mana to remove a creature. In here is also things like Nature's Claim, 1 mana remove an artifact or enchantment, things like that. So, rating-wise, Seth and I gave specific removal a C, Krim a B, Tomer an A. Do we
sounds
like
about right.
Swords to Plowshares? Tomer, what is the strongest case for Swords to Plowshares?
Okay, so so generic removal obviously has a better effect, but the thing that specific removal that I highly value is how mana efficient it usually is. Deadly Rollick, if you have a commander out, it's free to cast. Swords to Plowshares costs 1 mana. And let me tell you, the amount of times Swords to Plowshares have saved my bacon where a Generous Gift could not, it's incredible. Like, having 1 mana up is such a smaller ask than having 3 mana up for most decks. Unless you're like draw go or something like that, where you constantly have your mana up at all turns. The difference between 1 and 3 is really big. And that has been the saving grace in so many times where I'm being attacked for lethal and I can remove either it's one threat that's going to kill me, or it's like a lethal amount of attacks and I just remove one attacker so I get to live. It's really, 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 really good. And it's specifically the exile creatures, because usually it's a creature that's going to be killing me, as opposed to an enchantment or an artifact. That's not always the case. And that's always the downside, too, is because there's versatile ways of losing the game. But I love the fact that it's super mana efficient.
Yeah. I mean, go ahead, Grim.
Well, no, I mean, like, Tomer pretty much nails it on the head there, right? Being able to, like, do stuff, like, remove stuff at a very efficient cost is worth how narrow it can be. Although, as years progress, like, I mean, Answer's getting more versatile and at a better rate, like D-Spark, and, you know, soon there will be Wii Spark, and then that'll, like, probably pick something off, like, that's 2 or greater, right? The removal's getting better, and I think spot removal still is needed just because of those reasons. Because, let's not lie, the majority of things you're going to run into in the game of Commander is a creature, right? Mm-hmm. So why not have something that's just cheap and efficient?
I'm on the other end where, like, I value the flexibility way more than I value the efficiency. As much as There's times where Swords to Plowshares saved you when Generous Gift wouldn't have. There's also times where Generous Gift saves you when Swords to Plowshares wouldn't, because you're dying to an artifact or an enchantment or a land, and you just can't deal with that with a Swords to Plowshares. So I kind of feel like in 2023, we have so much flexible removal that's in the 2-3 mana range that it's a really tough sell for me to play 1 or 2 mana removal that only deals with a creature when I can pay 1 or maybe in some cases 2 more mana and be able to deal with literally anything on the battlefield. So for me, like...
Do you like Deadly Rollick?
It's just better Swords to Plowshares, right?
Yeah, I don't normally... I really don't play cards that can only kill a creature. Like, very rarely do I play cards that can only kill a creature. Instead, I'm going to play Assassin's Trophy instead of Deadly Rollick, or Beast Within over Deadly Rollick, or whatever. So that's kind of where I come from. What about you, Richard? I think you're more on my end of the scale when it comes to removal.
Yeah, I agree with Seth. I think in 2023, a lot of things that kill you or need to be removed are not creatures. So yes, this is the most efficient creature removal, but we don't play efficient enchantment removal. We don't play efficient artifact removal or planeswalk removal because it's too narrow. So I will take the hit on mana value. Like, I will cast things at 2 or 3 mana for the versatility rather than the efficiency. So I'm waiting for Power Crept Generous Gift. We have Deadly Rollick, which is 0 mana Swords to Plowshares, right? So I'm waiting for Generous Gift at 0 mana, and then it will be glorious. Yeah, I don't know. Like, do you guys play spot removal of other types? Like, what would be the second most common type other than creatures? Like, probably artifacts, maybe?
I personally don't. I'm on Crim's end, where I think 9 times out of 10, the thing that's killing me, at least in my play groups, is creatures. Like, it's usually it's combat damage, not combos. But even when it's combos, it's usually creature combos. Like, somebody's Blood Artist swing me, and I got to remove the Blood Artist to end the combo, for example. Like,
and the fact that it exiles, like, swords permanently ends that nonsense, right? Like, that.
I would say I don't really value
Nature's Claim anymore.
Yeah. If you are going to play a single target removal spell, it should be targeting creatures. Because I think you're right that it is the most common way to die. So I don't play any of the ones that just hit artifacts or enchantments. But I don't play the creature ones either, because I just rather play something that can hit anything.
If I am going to play anything that hits artifacts or enchantments exclusively, that's where I just use versatile ones and pay the extra cost tax or whatever.
Generic removal. So we alluded to this. So this would be like Beast Within. That's 3 mana, remove something, and then there's side effects. So Beast Within creates a beast, but there's other cards that don't. Like, for example,
Anguished Unmaking,
Assassin. I guess Assassin's Trophy gives a land, but there are other cards like that. So rating-wise, Tomer and I gave it a B. Krim gave it an A. S for Seth. S, really. Seth really likes it. S for Seth, which is interesting.
These are the first cards I print in my deck. Every time I
build
a commander deck.
How many do you put
deck,
in your deck if you like them so much?
maybe 3. It kind of depends a little bit on your colors and what options you have. Yeah. But if I'm in the colors, I would be jamming Beast Within, Generous Gift, Anguish Unmaking every time. Like, if I'm in the Amazon deck, all 3 of those are going to be in my deck. But if I build a green deck, Beast Within is like one of the first cards I put in. It's on my just like always play this no matter what my theme is. Same with Generous Gift in white. So I'm really high on these cards for the reason I was just talking about. Like, they can deal with anything, and there's a lot of powerful threads split between card types these days. So while it might not be quite as good at stopping that one Voltron creature that's coming at you, the flexibility of dealing with a Mirari's Wake that's doubling your opponent's mana, dealing with a Field of the Dead that's going off and making a ton of zombies, like all these different things that can end your life in a game of Commander, I think that makes these cards some of the most powerful in the entire format, honestly.
I do love them. I do, like, I play a good chunk of these as well. So already, like, dedicated between spot removal and universal removal, somewhere in there, I probably got about, like, 8 of those to 9 of those in my decks.
You play a lot more removal than I do.
Yeah. Oh, I mean, the thing is, I do that in my aggro decks, too. Because I probably, in my aggro decks, since I build a little bit differently, so, like, aggro decks, I probably won't play as much straight-up just creature removal. I'll play something like a universal removal, like a Beast Within or an Anguish Unmaking, because if I'm already, my deck is going to be gumming up the board, right? I'm fighting for the board already, so I'm not too worried about creatures. What I am worried about is something like an Eldrazi Monument, making your creatures just better than mine. So that's where my versatile stuff comes in. So mm-hmm. I even play around like 5 to 6 spot removal, like universal removal spells if I can, in like aggro decks.
It's the best spot removal in my opinion, but it's still spot removal, right? So that's a 1-for-1 spell, which means you're going down against the table, but it also means like you need to use it kind of, right? So the, you know, obviously if someone's hitting you with like a 21 power Voltron Commander, you fire it off. But if someone's mm-hmm. hitting you with a 4-4 creature with vigilance to get value from their sword or something, like, are you going to fire off your Beast Within on them? Like, so
probably on the sword.
It doesn't stop with those little pot shots that are coming in, right? Like, if people are just like nickel and diming you to draw cards from Toski or to trigger whatever the heck, like, this doesn't really help you. So while I do play these cards, I keep it at the B category because I only play like 1 or 2. I don't want to load up my deck like Krim. I just play as little as I can get away with. So, you know, it's for the end when I'm about to die, I can use it. But there's lots of things that doesn't stop you, like a go wide deck, an ETB like Crater Hoof. Like, this doesn't save you. So, you know, it is versatile, but, you know, I don't know. I just know it feels bad on turn 3 snapping off this thing because someone's hitting you with like their 7/7 hunted whatever garbage they played, right? Like, you don't really want to be doing this.
All right.
So, still spot removal.
I'm kind of with Richard a little bit, like on the philosophy where I don't want to have a bunch of cards that like I have to snap off to just take away chip damage. I think we could say that about a lot of some of the cards in our categories we're going to be talking about soon. But the main thing that I have against it is that, like, while I run Generous Gift and Beast Within in all my white decks and green decks, and I'm starting to run Chaos Warp now in all my red decks as well. Like, I really value these cards, and I'll put them in all my decks. But when I think about, like, what cards are going to save me from dying, I actually put Source of Postures above these because, again, like, it's just the mana efficiency. Like, I'd much rather have a Snuff Out or a Deadly Rollick in my hand because 9 times out of 10, I won't have 3 mana up. And then somebody's going to be like, all right, well, I played these hasty attackers. I swing at you for lethal. What do you have? And I want to make sure that I can cast the spell in my hand that can save me. So I like generic, but if it comes to living, then I'm going to go for a Swords.
I feel like maybe people get too caught up on the idea of like saving you being stopping the creature that's attacking you and not the Rhystic Study that's drawn that person 20 cards over the 3 turns before, or the Mirari's Wake that's doubling their mana for the 3 turns before. In a lot mm-hmm. of ways, saving you isn't necessarily on that one turn when you're getting like Voltron attacked for actual lethal. It's the stuff that took place in the turns before that gave your opponent that board state to present that lethal attack. And that's where I think the Generous Gifts and Beast Within's really pay off, is being able to stop the things that get the person to the position where they're about to kill you, more so than Swords.
There might be a category where I prefer answering those things a different way.
Ooh.
A little foreshadowing, perhaps.
Let's give Krim a little action here. Counterspell. Okay. So I gave Counterspell a B. Everyone else gave it an A. Now, Counterspell is essentially spot removal in the sense that it removes something off the stack. And it's generic, like Beast Within, because you know, it you can counter anything aside from cards that say they can't be countered. The only problem with Counterspell is that it's temporal. Meaning you have to have mana at that exact instant, and you have to counter it on the way down. So I'll go first because I like it less than you guys. The problem with Counterspell is that you are forced to make a decision without all the information. So if someone casts Crater Hoof Behemoth, okay, and it's enough to kill one person, but not the table, do you counter it or not? Like, do you know if it's hitting you, or do you know if it's hitting your opponents? Right? So you have to make that decision without that knowledge, so it's tough. And I don't think it's as catch-all as people like it. I think it's an exceptionally strong card because you can proactively progress your game plan, but I don't know. Like, you can let a scary threat onto the table if it's not hitting you. And if you have time to deal with it, you can just let it sit there. Whereas Counterspell doesn't give you that luxury. You kind of have to make that decision at that point and snap it off. So I just play like 1 to 2 counters in my deck, and mainly as a way to protect my game plan, but in a pinch, stop my opponent from killing me. But I just don't like the temporal nature of it. It has to be that exact turn, and you have to know it's coming for you, and then you snap off your counterspell.
But isn't protecting your game plan also a way of keeping you alive? Like, if you need a blocker to live and somebody, like, swords it, and you know that if you don't have your blocker anymore, you're going to die, but you have a counterspell, isn't that, like...
Yes.
Is that a way of keeping
you alive? In that case, it's keeping you alive, right? But you could mitigate that by having two blockers, right? Or you could have, like, a Maze of It or something. Like, there are other ways to get around that, right? Yeah. Like, in that specific scenario. So there are other cards you can use. But, yeah, like, of course... If someone, like, burns you for 20 to the face, yes, you counter it so you don't die, right?
Yeah.
I feel go ahead, Grim.
Isn't this... So, this is a weird one for me, because Counterspell is either an S or an A, but it's, like, kind of high up there for me, right? Because I feel like this card, like, this whole archetype of card allows it to be so flexible. Like, let's say you don't have the information needed, right? I can then talk to you.
Yeah,
and very simply,
is that coming at
if,
me?
If you try to do the Richard answer, I do not have the information to confirm if I'm hitting you. I'm just going to counter it, right? Yeah. Like, it's very easy. Like,
and we've seen that play out time and time again too.
Right, and so the thing is, it's nice because this card will literally save you, right? Like, if someone is about to do something where if it resolves, it's over. This is the one of the few ways where you just get rid of it while it's not on the board. One of the few ways to interact on the stack. And I don't know, the temporal nature of it where, like, yeah, it does suck where you draw the counterspell after, right, after the spell's resolved, but this has, like, some really low floors, but perhaps one of the highest ceilings when it comes to saving your hide. So I think this is either an A or an S. So, like, and there's a good argument for it just being S because it's the one of the few ways where you can stop something before it ever exists in any point. Problem is, there's also ways to loop things, you know, reoccur them, so who knows from that point. But I don't know. I mean, I have to imagine when it comes to saving you, not even letting your opponent ever cast whatever it is that you might need saving from is pretty good.
Yeah, I'm actually pretty much with Krim, where I think there's a pretty good argument this could be S tier. It does something that's, I guess, outside of Teferi's protection, is kind of unique in that it stops kills that don't involve creatures at all. We've been talking about swords versus Beasts Within. There's some combos like Thassa's Oracle combo. It doesn't die to Beasts Within. It doesn't die to Swords to Plowshares. It doesn't matter how flexible your targeted removal spell is. It's just going to win the game. Counterspells are the one way to interact with that. Or like various storm style combo kills, stack style kills, infinite turn loops. Those are things that don't really care about the permanence on the battlefield, but counterspells stop them. So I don't play nearly as many as Grim does, I don't think. I kind of like Beasts Within. I'm in the, like, I want to play two or three in most of my decks. But I feel like the flexibility helps make up for the fact that there's that big timing restriction, because this just stops stuff that none of the other things were. There's some kills that this is the only thing outside of Teferi's protection that's going to keep you alive.
All right, so efficiency question. Do you play, like, Swan Song, which is, like, one mana, counter an instant or sorcery, and then give them a bird? Or do you play more generic but expensive ones? So Counterspell, two mana, counter target spell. Right, but there are counter spells that target, like, non-creature spells only for a cheaper rate. How do we feel about those versus the more general ones? Or Richard's favorite, Forbid, which is a 3-mana counter spell, which is, like, a terrible rate, but you can buy back for 2 to ensure that nothing is resolving once you're set up. Like, how do you guys feel about the spectrum here?
My early Commander days, I played Forbidden a lot of decks, right?
Me too,
because of the buyback. But, like, yes, let's just say Swan Song or like it is one of the cards or one of the 1-mana counter spells. Those exist. I'd play them depending on the deck, right? Like, if I'm playing my tempo deck or my flyers deck or, you know, like my rogues deck, yeah, I operate on a low mana curve and I like having the ability to just hold up 1 mana and then play my bomb, right? But if it depends on the archetype, if it's a control deck, I'm going to want to go with the more versatile counter spells outside of mana drain. Mana drain is just ramp. So, like, the, like, literal counter spells and, like, fierce guardianships are really good for protecting your commander, and I just feel like, even though that one's more narrow, it's just generically good. So fierce guardianship is a house. I love them all. I think the beauty is that counter spells can fit everywhere in my deck, except...
I love them all.
I love them all. They're all great, except cancel. Like, the 1-mana ones are very much so, though, in a deck that is either a combo deck where you're planning on using something like you're going to combo and you need all the mana at open possible, or you're an aggro deck where a bird doesn't matter when you have an army of giant sea creatures or something.
I think in so I'm like on board with Krim and Seth on it, by the way. Like, I think the fact that it's flexible, it's like a generic removal spell where it's flexible, it can answer basically everything, including stuff generic removal can't answer because if it has to be on the stack. But also it protects your game plan, which is super important. But then also I think Fierce, we can agree. I mean, we've done an entire podcast on counter spells. We did a tier list on it. But we can agree, like, Fierce Guardianship is kind of like elevated over the other ones, right? Like, the fact it's
not over Mana Drain.
Okay, well, Mana Drain's a ramp spell. It's different.
It's one of the best counters.
Yeah, I think it's I still, yeah, I think of it.
Yeah, but we were talking about, it's a free counter spell if you have your commander out, right?
We were talking about we can't wait to see Generous Gift when it shows up for zero mana. That's Fierce Guardianship to me. It's better. Better than a zero mana Generous Gift, even. It's although, wild.
Like, Fierce Guardianship, isn't it, like, pretty narrow for keeping you alive? Like, because it's not dealing with creatures. It only stops. Like, it's good at protecting your game plan. In general,
it stops combos. It stops,
that's true.
It stops non-creature combos. And if you have blockers, which you should, then it helps prevent, you know, your blockers from being removed so people can lethally attack you and stuff. So, I don't know.
Yeah. It's
very good.
I view counters like I view the removal spells. Like, I would rather pay 2 mana for a counter spell than pay 1 mana for a swan song. Like, I want the flexibility to be able to deal with whatever I need to.
I'm on team swan song. I go, like, fierce and then, like, offer you can't refuse, swan song. Then probably Arcane Denial over a counter spell, but also Mana Drain's there. Yeah.
What's funny is I value Swan Song issue, like offer you can't refuse underneath the 2 mana counters. Yeah. They are mana efficient. Yeah, I mean, it does. But like even let's just say then like even my like tempo-y decks, right? I want to have universal answers. Like okay, offer you refuse hitting non-creature makes it a lot nicer. But in reality, Arcane Denial I want just way higher. I pay 4 mana for Urtai Resurrected. I think that card is really good.
That's because you play like 15 counter spells. Yeah. You're really reaching after a while. But the rest of us are playing three counter spells. They're like, wow, I'm going to make Urtai or worse.
I think y'all are pull out my junk cards pile. Like Urtai or Resurrected.
Really good. Because it solves a temporal problem, right? If something sneaks in under your counter spell, Urtai can still clean it up.
Urtai is good. I'm not trying to shade it, but I'm just saying it's not as high. It's like the sixth best. And also Jwari Disruption, A+.
Jwari Disruption is S tier, right?
Because it's also that is the
I'm just gonna link the podcast when we talk about all of these.
Okay, I'm gonna move Counterspell to the front of A tier.
Okay.
Right? Oh, because we think it's actually really good, and then it also does things outside of keeping you alive, like protecting your board and like making sure you win.
Yeah.
Have to imagine it's the best at keeping you alive though. Like in the context outside of what we're doing protection. This podcast, like outside of Teferi's protection, and you know what's funny is because counterspells technically could also stop a Teferi's.
Okay. I disagree. No.
We disagree. We're gonna go to a new category here as my counterpoint, which is attacking deterrence.
Sure.
Okay. So this would be like Ghostly Prison. This is like if your opponent wants to attack you, they gotta pay 2 mana for each one. I gave it an S. The rest of the crew gave it a B. So that averages out to A. So Counterspell prevents one-shot kills.
That's not how averaging works.
I don't know how that's actually.
That's three.
Okay, really? Okay. I'll put it to B, okay?
The Excel sheet says, but I don't believe the Excel sheet. That was who made this math. Excel sheet?
Richard.
So Counterspell stops the one-shot kill. When something is coming down and it's like deadly, right? Like Seth said, right? Like it's the last thing you remember. It's the thing that hits you in the face. And kills you. Ghostly Prison prevents that 20 chip damage you took in the beginning of the game that leads you to getting one shot later. And I feel this is actually very important. I feel the majority of damage in Commander is people getting value, right? So they're trying to trigger their Toskies, they're trying to trigger whatever like combat triggers they have. They're trying to attack with creatures for value. that's a lot of damage. And like, it makes no, if someone plays a 2-mana 3/1, it makes no sense to counterspell it, but they can decide to hit you for the next 4 turns and you take 12 damage. That's not good for you. And if two people are doing it, because like, let's say you're stuck on lands and you're the only one open and they're like, I don't want to hit you, I need to draw off my sword, and everyone's doing it, you're like dead in like 3 turn cycles. So I actually really like Ghostly Prison. It's the, if someone wants to steal your car, they're going to steal your car. But if you lock the doors, take out all the valuables, you're probably good to go, right? Like you know, most crimes are not a crime of like targeting you and trying to steal your car. It's a crime of opportunity. So this is like, remove all opportunistic attacks because it causes a tax, and therefore it's no longer favorable for you. So I really highly value this. And I think it keeps you alive better than a counterspell, like in the course of a game.
But even though, see, the problem I have with this is, you're essentially, okay, like you said earlier, right? These are just chump attacks, chip damage,
yep,
right?
Yep.
So you're building in, like, you're playing cards that are trying to stop an asset of the game, or a lane in the game that just doesn't matter. You're trying to stop a bunch of creatures that don't matter.
Chip damage matters. Well, that's chip, where we disagree with, I mean, right? I think the majority of the damage you get is chip damage, and then you get like one kind of lethal finisher off attack, right? Rather than you're at 40 and you take like 40 to the face.
I would rather play more of something else, but we'll get to that category. But the thing here is, like, attacking deterrence, unless you're like a pillow fort deck or something like that, you're essentially adding in half measures to your deck.
They're, I think they're pretty full measures. Have you ever seen our games when someone plays Ghostly Prison? No one until like the late game actually pays the 2 or the 4 or the 6 to attack that person. They're just like, well, okay, like I'm going to attack someone else until this is removed, or until it's like so late that you're going to actually like close out the game. So I actually feel like it's a pretty full measure, isn't it? Or is it? Do you really view it as a half measure?
It's not. I still think it's a half measure because it's a bunch of, let's just say, no Shieldreds, no fancy effects, right? Just a bunch of vanilla statted creatures, right? So at that point, your opponent has just played a bunch of grizzly bears, and that means your deck is doing nothing? And, why not just, if there's just a bunch of, like, non-factor creatures, just answer them permanently. Instead of playing these little, like, half-measure things where you, yeah, somebody else go deal with them. Somebody else will deal with it, right? It is nice, though. The reason why I do like attacking deterrence is because it lowers the other people's health.
Yes.
But the problem is, if it's if somebody's trying to attack you for value and you're still the only one open, they're probably still just going to pay the 2. I've seen that happen, but that's just because, like, hey, I have a sword.
I've never seen that happen.
I've never seen it. Unless you can't cast anything. Like, if you're early mid-game, that 2-mana costs a lot if you'd rather just cast a spell, you know?
Isn't this the fairy's protection for the first, like, 5 turns of the game or something? Like, no one is going to touch you with this on the battlefield. So, and then in the late game, it turns off and it's not effective, right? Because people will be like, I have 10 mana to cause lethal to you, right?
So when I started playing Commander, I would have rated this as a D, and actually up until kind of a couple years ago, I would still rate it like a trap card, like an F, because I started playing in a meta, a play group that was very combo heavy, and this does nothing to your opponent's combo decks, because they're not even interested in attacking you. So what was the point of this? It felt like an empty card. But I've noticed at least my play groups have shifted more and more towards combat, and Wizards of the Coast definitely is printing way more cards that are like Richard said, incentivizing attacking, not just the swords, but like I would say like half the commanders or archetypes are basically, when you attack, you draw a card and make mana. Like that's kind of like how it works these days. So yes, I do agree that shifting the chip damage away is very helpful. I don't think it's going to overall, I think it kind of balances out in the end, though. Like if you're at low health and somebody can attack like 2 people, they're like, oh well, he's at low health, I'm going to attack the guy at higher health. I don't know. It kind of, I feel like it does. I kind of agree a little bit with Krim that the early damage doesn't matter too much. And this does not save your bacon if somebody wants you dead, because they could pay the 2, or they could just remove it. And then you just have like this false sense of security that just got blown up. So I don't know. I like it. I value it early mid game. And also, Krim alluded to, there's a one way you can solve things better. And I agree. I totally agree. but I have made a conscious effort not to run those future the future category as much for the sake of everybody's mental health. So I'm starting to value this more.
Okay, so obviously y'all are talking about Wrath, so as being like the permanent option to deal with creatures. Since we're hitting around that, like, I think it's important to point out that Ghostly Prison is like kind of a Wrath that sits on the battlefield that still lets your opponents take damage. So there is like upside. I think the comparison isn't one to one. Like, sure, you could cast a Wrath and clean the board, but then people are going to play more creatures. Ghostly Prison is still sitting out there. It's still saying like attack other people instead of me. So I think it's actually like there are upsides compared to just like sweeping the board, having this effect that sits on the battlefield. My problem with Ghostly Prison, I think it's good. I think the chip damage preventing that, it's very effective at that. And that does keep your life total high. Makes it less likely that you're going to randomly die. We've certainly seen games where someone like gets off to a slow start and people are like, I want to trigger my stuff, and that person gets attacked and they get to a really low life total and they're just like hanging on for the rest of the game, like knowing they could die at any moment. Like, that's a thing that can happen in a game. Ghostly Prison's really good against that. On the other hand, it only stops creatures, and it only stops creatures that care about attacking, and it needs to stay on the battlefield. So as Tomer said, if someone really wants to kill you, they either get enough mana that they pay for it, or they kill the Ghostly Prison and then kill you. So it's hard for me to put it much higher than a B, just because I think it's very good at its role, but its role is like only stopping certain things and only why it stays on the battlefield compared to like a removal spell that deals with a threat permanently, or like a counter spell that's not just dealing with creatures but other things as well. So I can't rank it as highly as those other categories.
The problem is you're still falling behind, because let's say it's going somewhere else, right? All this damage, all these attack triggers, they're going somewhere else, yes. But you're still behind because they're climbing up cards, they're climbing up in value, they're establishing a way better board presence or sculpting the perfect game plan. All you've done is just literally the analogy or whatever of just being faster than the other guy in a zombie apocalypse. There's still a silly amount of zombies, dude. like nothing has happened. The plague is still going on, right?
Krim's gonna source the plowshares, every zombie.
Yeah, every zombie one by one.
That's one less of a zombie that you might get bit by. Better. Okay. That's better.
This category, I want your opinion on this. So Ghostly Prison propaganda, they're like very clear, right? They're just like, pay 2 mana for each one. What about creatures that when they die give you value? We all meme about like playing Solemn and like no one will attack you ever again. But like the Rectors, like things like, you know, when they die they give value. Does that count as a Ghostly Prison effect? Like, can we use this to just mind game people? Like, you play a Solemn and you attack me, give me a card? Sure. They're like, nah, I decline.
Okay, when you say Solemn, this sounds like a meme. But okay, let's say something like a little bit more threatening, I guess, like an Arena Rector or something
Arena
Rector.
Right? You don't know what's popping out of that. When it dies, you just put an enchantment on the battlefield? That's insane. I can't hit you.
But that's a different category. That's the blockers category, Richard. Right?
Is that a blocker?
That's a blocker. It's a blocker.
I mean,
okay,
I guess it's
kind of
blocker.
Technically
a blocker. It's a blocker.
We're
going to
count that as a blocker.
I would count that as a blocker.
Yeah, I'd count it as a blocker as well. Along with Death Touch
but
whatever else there is.
But its little job is to block.
But its blocking isn't to like stop things from attacking you repeatedly. It's not like a wall where you're like soaking up that combat damage that's coming for your face. It's more like...
Is it not?
Well, it soaks up a single attack and then dies, but isn't the reason that people wouldn't attack is because of the thing that you would tutor up, not because, you might soak up the damage?
I would vote for this.
I mean,
I
think that still falls under a blocker.
We'll put it in the blocker category.
Some type of blocker, I guess.
Okay, hold on. Let's just get sweepers out of the way.
Can we
alluded
get sweepers?
To sweepers.
Okay.
We all heard on sweepers that. As S tier, okay?
Yeah.
And the best sweepers, probably Farewell or something like that. Undo Inversion, Our Revelation. But sweepers basically just clean up everything. You have creature sweepers, and then you have the white sweepers, which just do literally everything, and modal as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we're not going to talk about like the deck building, like, oh, the morality of, oh, should you play this or not?
I was going to bring it up, though.
But like, never mind. We will talk about it.
Okay, it's S tier, but Tomer, you choose not to play too many sweepers.
Well, I used to run... Okay, so I'm a big advocate of one-sided sweepers, asymmetrical effects, if you will. I love board wipes that leave my board untouched, but ruin your opponent. So the one that's universal, Cyclonic Rift, does that at instant speed, bounces your opponent's stuff. But basically every archetype now has at least one of these board wipes. You have, for example, Crux of Fate, which is destroy all non-dragon creatures. So if you're in a dragon deck, you're just chilling. There's one for giants that deals damage to non-giant creatures. They all have it. Like destroy the things that are bigger power than your hobbits, you know, like all those things. I love those because they push your opponents back. They reset them, put them back in the Stone Age, but then you can go and kill them. Farewell and Stuff is really good. Objectively, if you want to not die, these cards are objectively, I think we all put it at S, we all agree that it's the best way because it stops your opponents from progressing their game. And if your opponents cannot progress the game, they cannot kill you. That's just how it goes. But after, like, you know, we're on episode 10 on Commander Clash or something like that, we had a lot of board wipes. A lot of board wipes. And the games are very long. And it's taxing mentally on it. So I've actually cut back on my full board wipe, my farewell effects, just for the sake of the group.
I'm in a camp where I think that we as content creators, you know, we curate our games, right? Like, because, you know, there's a level of like, hey, do you want to watch a 4-hour video? Probably not, right? Or like, maybe you do. I don't know. But the point here is I do think that we should probably, like, for the health of a game, like a play group, we should let you, I'm going to let you know that even if we reduce the number of board wipes we play so the games don't go longer, I think board wipes are a much needed part of the game and allow you, so like for the health of your gameplay, you should not, and you don't want to die and you want to stay alive, you should play board wipes. I don't think anybody should ever be cutting Farewell from their deck, right? Like, and yeah, maybe the card that whatever blows up all things with greater power. Yes, that's an awesome card. I love that. It's mana efficient. It does everything you need it to. But what happens when you have nothing and you're just behind, right? Like, so I do think generic sweepers are just too important not to include.
I'm kind of in the middle where I know that Farewell is like literally the best, one of the best ways to stay alive alongside Teferi's Protection. Like, it is really, really good. At the same time, I don't know if it's actually a good card for the Commander format. Like, I don't know if the way that games with constant sweepers play out is actually the experience I want out of Commander usually. So I think it is really good. But even outside of, like, Commander Clash in a video that's going on YouTube, if I sit down to play a game at a Command Fest, I would much rather play an hour game and move on to the next game with the next group of people that want to play with me than play a 4-hour game where it's Farewell back to Oblivion again and again and again and just like nothing actually happens and everyone's trying to get in with the one creature that sticks for one turn cycle. So yes, they're objectively like the best ways to stay alive. But for me, it's more of a small doses thing where I want to play like 2 or 3 sweepers in my deck. So I have the option if I really need it, but it's not something where I want it to be my constant play pattern of just like, oh no, I'm like a little bit behind on board. I better sweep the board and set everyone back to the start of the game again. So that's kind of where I have come down with that.
Let me get sweaty for you. I join you, Crip. It's the skill differentiator.
Oh, my man. I love you, Richard.
It drags out the game. It drags out the game. So there's more skill expression because the game's just going longer. But from a fun perspective, it lets multiple people pop off. Let's say you had no interaction, okay? One person pops off on turn 3 because it's 2023. They win the game. You pack it up, right? But what you can do is sweep them. And then the next person who didn't, you know, put all their resources on the table gets to pop off, right? And just before they pop off, you sweep them too. So now two decks have popped off. Right? Yeah. And then the third person. And it just keeps going and going, right? So if we weren't content creators, I'd be playing like 9 Wrath every deck.
Would you really?
My man, Richard. Wow. I
play so many Wrath, even in my aggro decks, right? Because you can't out aggro the board. You put one creature down, everyone puts 3, right? So like you can't keep up by just playing creatures. What you need to do is let other people overcommit, sweep the board, then play your stuff and win. And yeah, like you need Wrath to kind of do that. And then Ghostly Prison lets you do that, right? It lets you not commit to the board while not dying. And then you clean it all up with a nice sweep. And then you just like 30'd for 2 the table. And then you play your creatures and win. But I agree with you. Like, it's weird to sit there and be Wrath continually. But if you want to be sweaty, I think that's what you got to do. Like, that's the optimal strategy.
Think of it this way, Seth. Think of it this way. I am somebody who's wanted to play with you all day long. I get in line. I get to finally play with the second best beard in Magic, right? And so
I'm the best.
Now
right?
I've sat down. I'm the best one. And then so I finally get in there, and then somebody just pops off, wins on game like turn three or four. I didn't really get to do anything.
Next game.
All right. Well, my one game
he gets
with Saffron
sign, he'll
Holland.
Sign your card or something,
yeah,
and then
I'll sign it for you. Yeah.
Seth will sign the like. I wish Seth signed my sweeper that allowed me to play my deck with Seth. You know what I mean? Like I don't know. Like if you want to think of it that even from that lens, it's like, well, I don't even get to play a game. Like I wanted to play a game with the content creator I enjoy, and all that happened is somebody popped off and won, and then all right, cool. Whoa. See you later, dude.
You're giving bad advice here, so you hard lock stack Seth. So he's trapping you for the next 6 hours as you continually destroy all his lands and don't let him win.
Just so it's clear, I'm not saying not to play
Seth. Just to Seth.
I'm not saying not to play Raz. I'm not saying they're bad. I'm not saying you shouldn't play him. For me, my most fun commander games probably involve 2 to 3 Raths. That might be the optimal number. The games when there are 8 or 9 or 10 Raths, I hate them. They're some of my least favorite games of Commander. That's just not enjoyable for me. So I think that's what I'm trying to say. Like, yeah, don't just let someone win the game on turn four. That's not a good experience. But the games where it's just like Wrath, Cyclonic Rift, get back my Cyclonic Rift, do it again, Wrath you again, and like nothing happens for 3 hours, it makes me question why I play the format of Commander when those games happen. Like,
Hearthstone boys. We didn't say zero board wipes. We just said not 10. Like,
No.
But the problem is, if everyone wants one board wipe a game, right? You have to have enough in your deck to actually get that one, and then sometimes you'll run hot and draw more than one. there's kind of a problem with deck building, right?
The precons all had like 3 board wipes in them, and it just so happened that we drew like 8 of them.
Right? Or like that one game where we had like Skullwinder loops on like one board wipe. Like, it's just like we only had one board wipe, but there were Skullwinder loops involved.
But that's why I'm so happy to see more one-sided board wipes. I think Wizards of the Coast is like printing one-sided board wipes for every single archetype, and then they're going to give us more of them. And I think like that's the way forward.
Let me blow your mind. If you Ghostly Prison and play nothing and then board wipe, that's a one-sided board wipe.
I will say, obviously,
this isn't the board wipe podcast, but I think that in what it does, board wipes do exactly what we need it to do. Right?
They keep you alive.
Very effective.
They are very good. I ranked it as Teferi's Pro still king, right?
I'm just saying I'm not going to run it as 10 of, you know, just because it saves me the best.
Right. No, I fully agree.
Let's go to another S tier card, okay?
That not every player should be casting 9 board wipes. But 3 per player per game.
Yes, 3 is good. It was a good number.
Yeah, exactly.
How many times do we think Fog should be cast a game, guys?
Zero.
Zero.
So Fog.
Oh, it's so good.
Seth gave it an A. Tomer gave it a B.
There we go. Oh,
okay,
C.
Tomer changed it to a C.
C.
Krim
Don't
ended
let Richard-
at D.
Don't let Richard lie to you, okay? This is I put it at F. Somebody change that to D.
F is not on our scale. I had to change it to D for the sake of math.
Fogs are wraths that let you keep your board and kill your opponents on the backswing. It's exactly a wrath, except you get to keep all your creatures and win the game. It does everything a farewell does, except you win and it costs 1 mana. Yeah.
I can't wait till you fog some Super Friends deck.
Well, I mean, I can say that about Supreme Verdict or Swords to Plowshares or Ghostly Prison, same thing.
But at least if there is a creature, it's gone.
Yeah, you get around
right?
the blocker. Right, what does it do against combo? Like, it's very meta dependent. It's like, yes, there are going to be
it's
some times.
Well, wait.
You were just a minute ago were all being like, oh, creature combat, it's 2023, it's all about creature combat. And now Fogs are like literally the best thing to stop creature combat. And everyone's like, oh, there's a lot of other ways you can die.
People
might have this planeswalker on the battlefield.
Just kill the creatures.
You get an instant speed wrath here? They crater hoof you? You're like, okay, let me wrath. Let me swords the plowshares.
I do swords the plowshares.
So I said Ghostly Prison is a half measure. This is a quarter measure. This is like actually probably even lower than that. Like this is like, oh, there's a pile of poop on my walking pathway. I'm going to just walk around it and now go get to you.
That's perfectly reasonable.
No, it's not reasonable.
Sometimes you just need to
sit down and start sweeping it. I'll just walk
around. I'm not as down on it as Krim, because I do think, like, yes, if you have an army and your opponents have an army and they swing at you and you cannot block it, then you can say fog, and then in response, I kill you, and that's great. But it's still a very specific situation. Like, it's not going to help you against combo decks. It's not going to help you remove the Blood Artist that's about to infinite drain you. If you don't have an army, and they have an army, and they attack you, and you fog, then they'll be like, all right, on my turn, I'm going to do it again. And then you still die. Like, there's a lot of situations where fogs just do not do anything. And that's why I put it as a B. It's actually a C, though. It's narrow. I will run Obscuring Haze.
Richard,
you sold me on Obscuring
Haze.
You have
spot removal as C.
Okay.
Yes, I would rather play Fog. I played just as many Fogs as spot removal. One each.
Yo, Fog is worse,
I will take out one of my board wipes and put in a Fog just for the sake of my mental health.
With Fog, right? Most people have a trump card, okay? They like, Crater Hoof, I smash the table, I win, right? You fog, and you're like, well, fog doesn't, like, remove all the creatures. But what happens is that player tapped out. The rest of the table is like, hey, that was a Crater Hoof, right? That guy's tapped out. We'll just all smash him and kill him, right? Or you sweep the board or whatever. But the thing is, fog is so underrated, nobody plays around it. Nobody, right? You see, like, 4 mana, you're like, oh, is that an Aetherize, you know, 7 mana, whatever is that?
Because they always have Teferi's Protection instead.
No one plays around Fog, so you always like, oh, I got lethal, I kill this person, they can't swing back at me, I can untap, I can do this thing, right? The Fog throws out all down the gutter. It's a really good gacha card, and it leads to huge power swings. Right? Like, it's not only that you stop your opponent, you probably killed them because they just tapped out and wasted all of their stuff. So I think it's really good.
Is Teferi's Protection
underrated,
a fog, though?
Is what?
Is Teferi's Protection considered a fog? Because then we all run a fog.
It is a fog, right? Like, a lot of times you just use it to fog combat damage.
It's like,
right?
So much more than that, but.
Yeah,
fog doesn't save your board and stuff like that. So Teferi's Protection. Let's just establish Teferi's Protection is its own category.
That's true.
Its own thing.
Pretty much.
Nothing. Let's not even put anything near it in light. Near it, okay? Now, Fog. Fog is. Okay, why wouldn't I just blow up your board? Why am I? I wouldn't be worried about a crit killing. Because
we want the game to end.
You have a route, 6 mana, instant speed board wipe. Like, you don't.
That's,
you thought they had nothing, but turns
better.
Out they made 20 tokens, have haste, and like put a coat of arms down. Right? Like, you're like, oh, I didn't expect this.
Route is a good card.
Route is better than a fog, though.
Route is very good, but like, okay, there's one route in the entire game, and it's in white. Right?
Settle the wreckage. That's like a super fog.
The other thing,
of the stuff.
The other thing you're missing, though, and this, I guess, maybe just doesn't apply to Crim decks, so maybe that's why this is a weird conversation, but like, Fogs let you keep your board, which, if you're not trying to win with a big board full of stuff, then that isn't really relevant, so I could see why you wouldn't really like Fogs very much in some of the decks that you play, but if I'm trying to, like, build a big board and kill people, sometimes you have the Farewell or the Supreme Verdict in hand, and your opponent also has a big board, and you're like, I really don't want to blow up my almost as good as board as my opponent just to get rid of their board, but I really can't let them keep this board because it might actually kill me. That's where Fogs are, like, so good, because you manage to, like, fizzle the attack and still have your board to do things with it. So I think that's, like, for me, one of the, outside of the gacha aspect, I think that's one of the biggest upsides. Like, it's like a Wrath that works for a turn, even if your board is full of creatures, where a normal Wrath doesn't work as well in those scenarios.
But wouldn't I just rather play an Aetherize? Like, even decks that do, like,
well,
have
one
a
is
board,
four
right?
mana, like, and one is, like, one mana to free. Like, Obscuring Haze is free. So, let's talk about counterspells you can, or sorry, fogs you can play. So, Obscuring Haze is the green
darkness.
Commander Cycle one that's free.
Yeah.
There's Literal Fog, which is one mana. There's Constant Miss, 2 mana green, buyback Sack a Land. There are certain decks that simply cannot beat that card. And then there's, like, the fog with upside that a lot of people play. So, like, Spider Fog, Arachnogenesis, Ink Shield. Is it Ink Shield?
Ink Shield. Yeah. So, Ink Shield.
5 mana? Yeah. But it's, like, 5 mana. You might as well be casting Rout, right? It's hard
to but it feels so good. It's not available in Magic Online. And, oh, my God. I played it one time. It's my favorite card now. It's already my favorite card. Yeah, it's 5 mana.
Arachnogenesis.
But it wins you the game. And yeah, also, there's like, a new one for elves, too.
They're a fog with the wincon stapled on, right? But a lot of times, you're just using it for the fog aspect. And then my favorite is Angel Song. It's a 2-mana white fog, 2-mana cycling. So if you are questioning whether you should be playing this card, you can start with that, right? And then if you're like, oh, this card is hot trash, cycle it away. There was I feel a lot of times, they'll just hold it.
There's another one that Seth actually turned me on to. I haven't tried it yet, but it's Prismatic Strands. It's 3-mana, 3-mana fog, so it's expensive. However, it has flashback of tap a white creature, tap an untapped white creature you control. So for 0 mana, you can have just like a random white creature on the battlefield, and if it's in your graveyard, you can actually just cast it for free, which is absolutely wild. Like, that's actually a really cool card. I remember it was played in like Pauper, I believe.
Yeah, it's awesome Pauper play, and that one's actually neat too because it says prevent all damage that sources the color of your choice turn.
It's not a
It's not a straight fog for creatures against like a multicolor deck, but it also can like prevent an earthquake or like any direct damage style spells that are like going at your stuff. So you get some sneaky weird upside there as well. So
that's cool.
I play fog in pretty much every deck if I can now. Like I try to.
How many fogs would you run though? That's a question.
Usually one. Unless usually I'm playing one. Like a turbo fog strategy or something. I typically play a fog.
You know what? You got me to try one fog in my decks.
It's enough to not attack. Like, so now when I attack Seth, I don't attack. Like, if he has open mana and I want to hit, I don't attack Seth because I fear the fog. It's like the counterspell, right? Like, you have double blue up? Questionable.
Yeah.
So once you establish yourself as the fog player, and you just hold up that one green or whatever, people will
so much
you
bluff
alone,
value,
right?
Yeah,
it's like you don't attack the guy with 5 mana up in Orzhov. You're like, I'm gonna get ink shielded into oblivion, so better not do that.
Do we consider like blue shenanigan cards or Settle the Wreckage as fogs because they require you to be attacked for you to actually want to cast
it's
them,
like
right?
An instant speed sweeper,
like Aetherize. Krim mentioned Aetherize. I kind of think like it requires attacking, right? Like, you can't just fire it off at somebody who has a random permanent on the battlefield. It has to literally be attacking.
Actually, they're not fogs. Do you know why?
Why?
Because they actually deal with the board.
I don't know. Aetherize just lets them replay all their ETBs and further their engine.
The Spirit of Companion just keeps getting better.
Look, not everybody is SpiritCompanion.deck, right? Like, so the point is, at least those deal with the board. Fog does not do anything. Maybe fog saves your life. Yes, I agree. But so could Aetherize. So could
Aetherize.
It's kind of like a continuum, right? And those are somewhere in between. Like, on this side, you have like the fogs. On this side, you have the wraths. And like Settle the Wreckage, Aetherize is like somewhere up in the middle.
Yeah. Settle the Wreckage
exactly
is ramp.
Class,
sorry,
but
I forgot about that. It's
that's right.
It's white token ramp.
I think fogs are underrated, though. Like, I don't think they're D's or C's. You know, they're not like A's, I don't think. No. Like, you can play one, right? Like, you can't load your deck with 5 fogs and, you know, get anywhere. But like, I think people severely underrate them from the misconception of 1v1 fogs.
And like, especially,
in 1v1, look, I've lost to Nexus of Fate, so don't worry, I don't undervalue fogs.
Well, that's turbo fog, that's different.
And also, if you're playing, how about this? If we count Ink Shields and Arachnogenesis as a fog, which they are, then they go up to C for me. Yeah. Because those cards at least can kill somebody.
Ink Shield's a win condition. That's a thing about Ink Shield. It's a little win condition.
Yeah.
And it's just worth mentioning, if you're only playing one fog, you can make sure that fog has cycling, so it's never going to be dead, so it makes creatures like Spider Fog or Ink Shield. So it's really easy, because I know people think, oh, it'll get stuck in my hand, it's not going to be good. But if you're only playing like one of them, you can easily get around that in pretty much any color that has a fog by playing a fog that won't get stuck in your hand for various reasons.
But then you just half the time you hope you don't draw it. That's the only problem.
Well, I mean, it's the same with spot removal, right? If I have a source of Plowshares, I'm not going to fire it off. I'm going to wait till I'm going to die, and hopefully I'm not going to die until late in the game, right? So you're just holding it all game anyway. So same with Hog, right?
If you had a generous gift and somebody puts Field of the Dead on the battlefield, you're going to be like, I'm going to wait.
I'm going to put a Ghostly Prison and see you guys later.
What if somebody puts down a Rhystic Study? Are you going to be just like, I'm going to chill?
I will not remove it. But that is
you
not,
will not,
that is not for this. That is not for this podcast.
Oh my god, we just found a spicier podcast.
I will remove the player. Like, I don't need to use a Beast Within on it, right? Okay.
Can't wait for that.
We have
one.
Another topic. I think this is severely underrated, okay? This category It's called blocking. Okay. I gave it an A. Seth and Grim gave it a C. Tomer gave it a B. Now, people are like, oh, what if people are hitting me with creatures? I have a solution for you. You can play your own creatures and block, right? So if you're like a green deck, you already know about this. But there are creatures that cycle. There are creatures that give value when you play them. For example, Spirited Companion is a blocker that gives you a card. Baleful Strix is the poster child here because it's a Death Touch flying blocker and it gives you a card and it has artifact synergies. But if you are a non-creature deck, like let's say you're a Storm deck or some kind of combo deck, or you know, you're a late game deck, I think you should play these kind of blockers to gum up the board, make sure people don't attack you, and survive until the late game. Versus like turn 2 ramp, turn 3 draw cards. Oh, why am I at 30 life? Turn 5 draw cards. Why am I at 10 life? Right? Because you played no blockers and people are just smacking you around. Blockers. It's a novel concept. Okay. We can engage in this aspect of Magic the Gathering.
Okay, so actually I think I can safely bump it up to B at least, because so when I heard blockers, I was thinking like, okay, my opponent has a big board of creatures. I also try to build an equally big board of creatures and like stop them from attacking me, which just seems a little hit or miss. Like that isn't always going to work out. But if the thinking is like, I want to get something on the battlefield early, in a lot of ways, a Baleful Strix is kind of like a ghostly prison almost, where like if people are choosing who to attack to trigger their whatever they're trying to trigger, they're not going to go after the person with the Baleful Strix. And it's so bad that no one's really going to care to kill it, if that makes sense. It's not like big enough to actually like threaten anyone, so it's not a priority to get off the table. So if we're talking about stuff like that, especially like a Baleful Strix that's cantrips when it enters the battlefield, I'm on board with that. I think that's actually like a very good and realistic plan. So I gotta bump it up at least to a B, because I think you are definitely very right that just like having something on the battlefield is usually enough to make the people attack the person who has nothing on the battlefield.
I've tried this.
This is why Tomer dies all the time.
No, no, no.
All the chip damage.
No, 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 no.
All the chip damage adds up. He's like, nah, I don't need a blocker.
You told me before, oh, just play blockers. And I played blockers. It didn't matter. They just kept getting wiped and wiped and wiped and removed and sniped.
Yeah, but if you're playing Baleful Strix, you get wiped, you don't care.
Shivel had a little sniper action on my Galadriel. Boom. Oh, Tomer doesn't have any blockers. Let's attack him. Blah, 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 blah. No, I think there's two ways you can handle aggression. First, you can be the try hard way, sweaty mode. You're just like, I don't care about blockers. I'm going to sweep every single turn. And I think that's objectively the better way, because if people are playing the commanders and stuff that actually they're engine pieces, if you keep removing their engine pieces, they can't attack you, nor can they play the game of Magic. But yes, the other way, if you don't want to be super sweaty, then yes, having all these cantrip creatures is much better. Not just having just like threatening creatures. Yes, your like spirit companion and stuff. It's like, but it's not as good. Fog. And it's not a guarantee to be like, oh, now you're not going to die because I've tried it and it doesn't work. But it helps.
Let's be clear. Esper Sentinel is not a block. Like, you can't have a high value card as your blocker. Right?
Yes.
If you play Esper
or
Sentinel,
Arbor Elf,
people are going to be like, oh, I'm just going to remove that. Or I will gladly attack into you so you chump.
Yes, right? We're talking specifically about expendable creatures.
Yeah.
That's what
we're talking about. Not use
the Baleful Strix.
Yeah. We're talking about a Wood Elves, a Solemn, a Spirit of Companion. Yes. Those are kind of nice. They're not going to save your bacon later on in the game, but they're nice against chip damage. I agree.
They gain you a lot of life.
Yes.
They gain you a lot
of
life in the early game.
Well, also, somebody, your game plan, which is drawing the actual cards you want instead of this stuff, right?
I thought you were going to say like flipping dousing dagger. How are you going to flip the dagger without a creature?
Yes, it chips down planeswalkers. it triggers your Toskies. Like all
planeswalkers,
you know, we're talking about.
Are they blockers?
Someone plays Curse of Opulence. If you had a Baleful Strix, you can now cash in on that, right? Like there are advantages to attacking in 2023. So even a 1/1 is worth it, right?
I don't think they're like universally good. Like, yes, if you have like blink effects, if you have equipment, like there's a lot of stuff that make these cards better. But like, if you're like, I don't know, if you're like a random spell slinger deck, I don't think you want to be jamming a bunch of like spirited companions and whatnot.
You do, you just want to go for the board wipes. You're the kind of deck that dies. Everyone's like, It's Spellslinger.
Gotta kill
They're
Niv.
They're gonna wreck your face when they untap They're gonna start hitting you. So you need to play these spells.
I'm gonna make instant sorceries that are just board wipes. I'm just gonna board wipe the crap out of you, and you're just gonna be like,
oh. But I thought you removed
you don't have
them.
The mini board
wipes.
If I'm enemy number one because I pulled out a Spellslinger, then guess what? I'm gonna stay enemy number one because I'm gonna make sure none of you got a chance to do anything about it.
Well, then yeah, good. That's good. What you're supposed to do if you're playing spells. Slingers, you need to make sure you can back that up and live.
Oh God,
I've heard
it's a crib.
You see, yeah. That's what I'm saying. Like, look, especially you, Tom, you of all people in this, like from all the years we've done Commander Clash,
you made me
play
this.
These combos that are like, oh, I'm gonna kill you, I'm gonna get you. It's like, are they like?
I need to finish the job. I need to make sure you can't have any cards on the battlefield.
Finish the job, Tomer. Or right. Live long enough to
noted.
Do the job.
All right. I'm putting this on.
We don't like blockers. Nobody likes... Even Seth... Seth mocked
like,
me for playing Clockwork Servant. I remember this. I cried after that episode.
I'm not down with the Clockwork Servant.
It's a
three-mana, two-three
colorless creature. And then it's adamant. If you spend three mana of the same color,
that's a meme.
You draw a card.
That's
like,
a meme, dude.
That's like mega spirited that's, companion.
Doesn't there have to be a better way of doing that? There
but these cards like accomplish nothing. They accomplish. There's so minimal impact. Like, yeah, okay, they're fine blockers. They help you a little. Bit, but like, are you really spending three
no,
mana for a chump blocker that draws you one card? Like,
that's why you don't. So you don't have to fire off your Swords to Plowshare. So you don't have to prematurely fire off your Wrath. Right?
But then
you only have one Wrath. You can't just fire it off like willy nilly, right?
But if you're just playing a bunch of garbage cards and the rest of the table are actually doing high impact stuff, you're gonna fall behind. Okay, yeah, sure. Maybe you don't even die first. Maybe you don't even die.
You sweep them afterwards, and you're all caught up, right?
Yeah, but what if they're like ramping super hard, drawing a bunch of cards, and you're like, oh, okay, I sweep them, and then I still have all this.
Solemn ramps, draws a card, and is a Durly blocker. Goat card.
I've turned around on Solemn, actually. I kind of started playing Solemn again. I think I agree with Richard philosophically that getting on the board early and having something out there is a huge incentive to attack other people and really powerful. I don't know if I agree on the exact cards, though. You lost me at Clockwork.
What was it? No, Sky Scanner. I played Sky Scanner. Three mana, one flying.
That dies to the MDFC I play all the time, unfortunately.
And Seth had to use Spikefield Hazard on it because it was so threatening to him.
Richard's coming out with like the draft chaff that people would be like, I'm not really sure if I need a second one of these.
Okay, y'all and like, Richard plays no spot removal. He's so easy to kill. But like, you guys can never kill me. Like, it's actually very tough to kill me because
no,
I play blockers and
no,
I play the turns.
No, that's not why you don't die.
You gotta go out of your way to kill me and you're like, it's not worth the effort, so I'll just do something else.
It's a plan not
too much
to
work,
stay
just attack Tomer.
Your deck is literally, while Tomer's half playing his combo every game, you're sitting there behind a sky scanner so you dodge aggro.
Yeah,
does that translate into
staying alive, dodging aggro?
Yeah,
I mean,
and
yeah,
I killed because... Tomer in the process. What more do I want out of this?
Wild.
Poor Tomer.
Okay, so
if
like,
Tomer
like,
played
literally...
a blocker, then it would deflect the aggro somewhere else. Look at how it works.
Oh, I've tried that.
One of the last Commander clashes we played, you went a whole like game not getting hit because your commander was so bad.
Well, that was different. The deck was malfunctioning.
How does that
where is our play D tier Lord of the Rings commanders category? That's the ultimate way to not die.
Right. Yeah.
Bring it back to Baleful Strix. Let's not talk
well.
About Sky Scatters. Those are Richard's specials. Right. But Baleful Strix is a legit card.
Baleful Strix is a legit card. It's
you guys
mana,
like it better than
it
fog,
actually
right?
trades with stuff. It doesn't stop
yeah, it
chump
trades,
blocker.
It draws a card. It's reoccurring.
I mean,
Strix or Ghostly Prison? Strix or Ghostly Prison?
Strix.
I think I like Strix more than Ghostly Prison.
But it's behind spot removal, definitely, right? Behind.
Yeah.
Source
of but like,
yeah.
There's only one Strix. Like, if you're like Spirit Companion or Ghostly Prison, I'd probably take the Ghostly Prison.
Yeah, I mean, I'm also. I guess, hold on. Yeah, when I think of it in Strix terms, yeah, I like it over Ghostly Prison, but. If the idea is that it's a blocker, then I do not value blockers over Ghostly Prison.
I think this category is Strix and Solemn. Those are like the actual really good
cards.
And then it starts getting like really questionable afterwards. Like it gets the Clockwork Servant, it gets the like three mana two ones. Like it gets Spirit yeah, of Companion would be the next game.
You'd have
round,
to
I
pay
guess.
Me to put
Richard,
Clockwork
you're
Servant
to move
in
that
my
down. Throat. That's gonna that's going behind okay, Ghostly okay. Prison. I'll take that.
Prison,
again, half measure. Now we're going to quarter measures, and
look,
I don't
two
like
two half
that.
Measures is 100%, Krim. You gotta remember. You gotta do the math. It checks out.
Is okay, that right. Okay? All right.
Opponent attacking incentives. So this is cards that incentivize you to hit your opponents. So
aggro deflectors.
Curse of Opulence would be a very good one. That cool. is, you S-tier. Enchant a player, and whenever that player is hit or attacked, you and the person attacking make a treasure, or make a gold token, sorry. So B for myself and Tomer, C for Seth.
Y'all are haters on go.
So yeah. What else is on this list? So you got Curse of Opulence, yeah. various lesser curses, I guess. Like, what Edric, else are we
no
talking about?
Edric, Spy Master.
No Mercy
Edric got soft banned after the
Ghostly
first
Prison.
Episode of Commander Clash.
Yeah, that was your was commander, so... though. That's a little different than yeah,
but you can
playing
play,
the 99.
You can still, I mean, it's still very good in the 99, though. Because what are you going to do, not draw a card? They're going to attack like, me, the Edric player?
Aren't these, no. like, bad Ghostly Prisons? Like, I kind of view them as just, like... Ghostly Prisons, but if people want to kill you, they can. There's no like, oh, I have to have all this mana. If someone is just like, eh, you know what, I'm going to ignore this single treasure token for a turn.
Yeah.
They could just massacre you if they wanted to.
They could, but it's kind of like Rhystic Study where like everybody can say, oh, we're not going to pay the one, but you know, people are greedy.
I totally agree.
This is different, though. This is not even close to... Okay, Curse of Opulence and Edric and all that stuff, You're like, once you put choice into the equation, like, okay, the tax effect of Ghostly Prison essentially goes, all right, well, the choice is removed, right? I'm just not even going to hit you. Yeah. This one, I'm because you've given me the choice and you're putting me in a situation where I have to make more decisions than I already need to, I'm just going to hit you.
Yeah, you're making me think, so I'm going to kill you.
That's great for you.
This is increasing your odds of dying. This is not staying alive. This is increasing your odds of dying.
That is not my play experience. Even in Commander Clash, I put a Curse of Opulence on somebody. You're all hitting the Curse of Opulence person. You're all making that gold for both me and you.
I agree with Tomer. Like, in the early game, you play this early, you are going to deflect a lot of damage. But I feel like if I could just take you out and I got my board that big, I would just ignore the curse and kill you when I couldn't do that with Ghostly Prison. So I think that you're right. Like, even that tiny incentive of a gold token or drawing a card or whatever your curse is doing, like, that's usually enough to gain you a lot of life and deflect a lot of attacks other directions. But sooner or later, people are going to be like, okay, like, I'm going to just kill you now, and they can. And the protection wears off at that point.
My question for you then is, though, how is this worse than blockers? If we're talking like the chump, like the Baleful Strixes, the Solemns and stuff, is this not just better than those things? Because Strix is the only one that has Death Touch. Other ones are just chump blockers. They're just going to fall over if you have a 3-power creature. This one, though, doesn't require you to even have a blocker on the board. You just allow your opponents to be greedy. And it's wonderful. And you benefit too, even if if somebody's being attacked with the Curse of Opulence, not only are you redirecting attacks so you're not getting chip damage, but you're also benefiting. You're getting ramped. It's wild.
It is really good. The problem is people know you're pulling ahead. So even though I begrudgingly hit Seth to get the gold token, like, my eye is on Tomer. Like, I know he's popping off. I'm just being greedy at the moment, but I'm ready to stab him in the back at any second. Whereas, like, a Ghostly Prison, it's like, happily, you know, if you're a go-wide tokens deck, you're like, yeah, I got my eye on him. Otherwise, like, whatever, I'm just going to hit Seth, right? Like, it doesn't draw that aggro. So, yes, the gold is, you know, better, and a lot of times it is, but people know you're getting advantage, and they're keeping an eye on you, and they're ready to take you out, like, as soon as it's opportune.
And then I will say... I'll
take my gold to the bank and win the game. Then I'm
well. You see that's where I think this card comes in. I think if people see stuff specifically, I guess Curse of Opulence, people will probably they have to understand that you're pulling farther ahead every time that, like, you know, they're hitting whoever you're targeting. So They could just not do that and not be blinded by the
correct behavior is to start smacking the curse of Ockham's, like Risk Study, right? The correct behavior who says
not no draw to cards,
but yeah, who's gonna say no to it, right? No one, well, look, right? So
once people start attacking me instead of the enchanted person, I'll take curse of Ockham's out. I'll say it's bad, but it hasn't happened yet. So
I will say, like, curse only technically redirects one attacker, right? Like, you can if I have three creatures, I can smack you with two and send one at the curse player and still get the gold. Yeah. So, like,
but I still get the gold too.
You still get the gold too.
I usually barter to where it's like, hey, can I hit you? I'm going to hit you for a gold, but I'm going to hit you with the least awful thing, and then I'm going to send the worst over.
We see a lot of
that
happening.
Sure.
Yeah. Right? Over to, like, yeah.
And I'm still getting gold. I don't care.
I think
why
it's
do you think you die first, Homer? Think about that.
I got
all this gold. All
right. Okay. So above fog, apparently, above blockers or not.
I will just say fog. I would have fogs above all this stuff,
me
but
too,
I know
Seth,
I'm in the minority
gotta,
here.
We
got to
tease
so,
the masses here.
blockers think, over this.
I would put blockers over it.
Curse?
Because I would put
what,
curse
what is
here,
one
yeah.
of the philosophies you talk about, Richard? Board presence is the best politicking you could have.
Sure.
And if you have blockers and bodies, that's better. This is just putting you to draw aggro at, like, real bad.
I mean, there are cases where someone just has, like, a 15-15 vanilla. Like, no evasion, like, nothing, right? And the person that dies is the person without a single blocker. And, like, the person with a 0-1 plant token gets away with it because they just had, like, this one thing. So
you all keep saying, like, oh, this is why you die first, because how dare you generate mana and card draw and stuff like that. But, like, at most tables, everyone's doing this. They're just generating mana and stuff. So you can't just be like, oh, that one guy has to die because he's
I
doing
totally.
Things. Yeah. Not everybody's playing, like, Spirited Companions and stuff. People are actually progressing
really
the
good,
game.
But it's it also puts it puts a target on you while keeping you alive, if that makes sense. Like, in the short term, it keeps you alive. But people know, like, you're pulling ahead and they're ready to take you out. Or they should be, at least, if they're doing it right.
It just allows you to cast other spells that could further protect you or win the game. That's why I like it a lot.
It allows me to cast more cards.
I think it's one of the best cards. I think it's one of the best. Like, Curse of Opulence. And Curse of Verbosity is very good, too.
Yeah. Edric is very good.
Edric is his own deck, right?
Brina is very good.
Edric redirects all the attacks, too, which is nice. Like, that you reward your opponents for attacking with everything at opponents. Oh, God.
This is a
loose
category.
Are we talking about goads?
Oh, you guys hate goads.
So there are literally mechanics that say you cannot be attacked. I know Tomer loves these. Tomer gave it a B. We all gave it a C. What do we feel about these mechanics that prevent you from being attacked?
I think that they're like goat? Some of them actually play quite nicely. Yeah,
is
like goat
the only one? I can
but it's,
like,
it's,
maybe,
it's
maybe
not
goat,
just prevents you from being attacked.
Slicer.
It forces them to attack. Yeah. So goat says the goated creature must attack. And it cannot attack you if able. If it's 1v1, it's absolute trash, which is why I could never rank it higher than a B. Because once you do go 1v1, your goat effects turn off. But not only does it prevent you being attacked from the scary, threatening creatures, it also forces them to hit each other. So you're dealing indirect damage. And it also can force very unfortunate blockers. Like, if you're goading like an Oracle of Moldyr for some of your random utility creatures that cannot, like, tap to save themselves, they're just gonna die to blockers, which is wonderful. So I feel like it's a very soft situational removal, but also deals a lot of damage to your opponents while also keeping your life total very high, which is really good. It's just super playgroup dependent, because, like, I've destroyed tables with, like, Karthus, for example, which is just, like, Omega Goad for the entire table. And then I sat down at a table with two Sacrifice Aristocrats deck and a combo deck. And my Goad deck accomplished nothing. There was Goad creatures to be goaded, but they were, like, they were just, like, elves, and they tapped themselves, and then they would just sacrifice themselves and stuff. And I was like, all right, sad times. But, like, in our play group,
we'll rate this not in a dedicated goad deck, right? Because that's, like, an entire deck. But, like, if you want to stay alive, should you put, like, two goad cards into your deck? And
I would tell you on
the
Taunt from the Ramparts.
Goad, right? I think the vows, depending on the deck, right? Like, if it's, like, combat focused or something like that, then, you know, like, and you want people, like, to lose health, I could see me playing a few vows.
There's
they're
one
fun,
card.
But if they're I, not good.
Oof. There's one card I will try to sell you on, or at least the listeners at home. Taunt from the Ramparts. It's a new card from Lord of the Rings. It's 5 mana Boros. All your opponent's creatures are goaded, and they cannot block until your next turn. So what you do is you basically remove any potential blockers for your army, so you can attack freely, and then for their turns, they will continue to dish out the amazing damage. I've seen it played, like, Phil has it in his General Ferris Rockerick deck. He played it twice, I believe, in Barcelona. It was phenomenal each time. Every single person I've heard who played it loves it. It's really good.
But like that to me, that sounds like it's because it kills every, like, doesn't that just kill a bunch of people more so than like
it's a win con.
Save you? To me, it feels like a win con more than like a fog or a. Not that it seems very strong, but I don't know.
It's a preemptive fog.
I don't know if I put it in my deck to stay alive. I put it in my deck to make other people die, which maybe that's how you stay alive, is just taking everyone else out. But it does seem like a good card. Like, I think the card's good.
Well, imagine everybody's built up an army. You could die next turn because somebody has like a big flying evasive threat that you cannot deal with. You just cast this, and now everybody else dies. It's wonderful.
But would you put that in generic deck, or does it have to specifically go into...
If it has creatures, because that one also removes blocking. But this is like Disrupt Decorum is also just very good. Like, if everybody has a big board site, instead of like sweeping the board, you just be like, yeah, I'll kill each other.
So do you actually just run it like that? Like, do you just throw it in a random red Commander Clash deck or whatever just to like... So I have a Furkrag Goad deck, and I like the Goad mechanic in a dedicated deck.
Oh, God,
never play Goad cards outside of a dedicated deck, though. I haven't, maybe I should try it more, but I haven't gotten to the point where I'm like, oh, Disrupt Decorum's like a kind of a red fog sort of preemptively, and I'm just going to jam it for value. So I haven't got there yet, but maybe I'll have to try it more.
Spectacular Showdown. Everybody gets goaded in Double Strike.
That kind of just kills people like the Boros one, really. I have that's in my Furkrag Goad deck, good, like, and it kind of just makes people die.
That's like Insurrection, right? Like,
basically,
the best defense is a good offense, right? So I just Insurrection kill the table, and I'm alive. But does that change our opinion on this category? Are we still at C here?
No. Yes.
I still think it's at a C just because, like of saving you, Fog is higher than this, right?
But they literally can't kill you on your turn. Like, if you
you're going like one creature or something, right? Like, depending on what this is, right?
We're always ranking the best version of each one. No, that's why we have like Strix up there, not the Clockwork.
you're comparing a expensive card that does everything versus like a card like a single target, right? So like Swords versus Wrath, right? So I guess we can change this into a Go the Table card.
Yes.
I would play a Fog.
I don't like it because it makes them upset. Right? Like, they know, like, if they can get away without killing each other, they're just going to kill you right after because they know this is happening. It's like Slicer, right? We all hit each other with Slicer. We're not happy about it, and we're trying to turn you. And then the goal as the Slicer player or the goading player is to just disallow it altogether, right? Like, make people do it and, like, not get out of it. But everyone's like, no, how about I send these ones at you and you block here or you do this? Or maybe I sweep the board and we all agree to kill the goading player or something. So it makes everyone upset. So you have to win. So I think the win con goad ones are really good, where you just win the turn you play it, or, you know, one cycle after you play it. But as a way to stay alive, they're like, oh, he's doing what he wants to do. He's popping off. We gotta stop this. Last card. Lands. The Richard special here. Maze of Ith. So it's a land that doesn't tap for mana, but you can tap it to remove a creature from combat. I gave it an S. Seth and Krim gave it a B. Tomer, an A. Y'all not put Maze of Ith in every single deck.
Oh, I put Maze of Ith as a D, but I really like Thematic Compass.
Oh, you like Thematic Compass? Okay.
Yeah, I wouldn't run Maze of Ith.
Maze of Ith does not add mana.
It's like Clockwork versus Strix to me. Like, I would put the I would put Maze of Ith.
What is the best Maze of Ith land then?
Probably the Skophos, Labyrinth of Skophos then.
Core Haven is two mana white.
But Labyrinth of Skophos is colorless, so it can go in any deck.
That's four mana, though. It's who's like going to pay five mana, kind of, because you got to tap your land, too. So you're just spending a lot of
drop. You can activate it to hit your land drops if you're missing them. And then it just by itself flips into a land. Yes. And then you can just Maze of Ith people.
But like, then is it a land or is it an artifact?
I mean, there is a time where people can remove it as an artifact.
Yeah.
Okay. How do we like... How do we like this card? We don't like it.
I don't play Maze. I don't like Maze. So I put it as a B, which I guess is only good in certain decks. I like it in decks that have a land theme, I guess. Mm-hmm. Or if I can use like Herbalwork or Yavmaya to make it make mana pretty consistently, then I like it. But I used to play this card much more than I do now. It's one of those cards that I feel like was a staple 10 years ago, but we've just gotten so many utility lands now that I rarely play it in a generic deck because I feel like it's just gotten beat out by other options.
You know,
they don't do the same
thing,
but what holds up?
Glacial Chasm.
Oh god, that's card's
a
so
land.
Brutal.
Yeah, that's a protection land category.
That
maybe
might actually, yeah.
That's a land.
That's also like basically a combo piece, kind of.
What do you think, Richard? Because I see you play this a lot of weeks in Commander Clash. What's your rationale with the Maze of Ith?
I will gladly go down a land drop, which is a very big deal, right? Because you're playing a land, but this is like, you don't have to remove any combat-y creatures coming at you. So this stops like anything from like the 3/3 that's chipping away at you to the like 20/20 like one-shot Voltron type things. In green and black, it's a free roll because you can play the lands that turn this into a normal land. I will gladly go down a land to play a Maze of Ith. Like, think of it as like a fog that's free to cast, but you got to sack a land when it it takes a land drop, basically. I don't know why everyone doesn't play it. This used to be very expensive, but they reprinted it. So it's come down in price. And I love Thematic Compass. I think it's great. You guys mocked me for playing it, so I'm glad Tomer has recognized it. That one ramps you. That one takes you up. Like, it adds an additional land to the battlefield. It taps for mana as well, and it helps you draw basics if you need it. But this stops any attacker. It's like, I don't know, a Swords to Plowshares that you can use every turn, right? Like, for attacking creatures.
I feel like if it made mana, I would play this in a lot of decks.
It would be cracked. It would be like S tier, right? If it made mana.
I feel like is taking a turn off of playing a land like not too punishing? Is that actually not
it's great in the late
problematic
game. This is probably even worse than drawing a Temple of the Forgotten Gods or False Gods.
You don't really want to play this as your land drop in like the first four turns or something.
You don't
want to
play
this
until like turn like seven, to be honest with you.
But like green deck, you can ramp it out. You can search it up when you need to, right?
If
like
you can tutor it up.
I put it in like a green lands deck where you're running a lot of lands and you can tutor it up when you need it because you're running crop rotations and whatnot. Then it's good. And you probably have Yavimaya too to get around the downside of it. But
I will say
it has any deck.
It has often looked good when Richard has had it on the battlefield. Like, it is another one of those cards where it's like, well, there's not really even much point in attacking Richard because he'll just Maze it. So I feel like it does look impressive on the battlefield, but I still don't put it in my deck.
When you start copying it, remember that game with Phil? I had triple Maze of it, and he was playing Voltron. I was like, sorry, Phil, you're not getting anywhere this week. But you can start copying it as well to just really stop all combats. And then when it gets too scary, you sweep the board. And then you still have these lands. Like, it survives through Farewell. So it keeps giving. Unlike Ghostly Prison, which dies with your Farewell, like, this thing keeps giving.
Late game, not unbeatable. And I know if I had it on the battlefield, you guys would easily just be like, if we all attack him, he can only block one, right? Like, so
if you're arch enemy, this is not going to save you.
Yeah, if you're arch enemy,
piece,
you're not doing any favors here.
It's kind of the clockwork servant of lands, I think.
we basically see the entire Richard deck laid out to us. We have Clockworks, we have Ghostly Prison Effect, we have Maze of Ith, and just hope nobody combos.
You got to use a lot of resources to kill me. Like, it's not worth it. And you're like, what am I killing it for? He's a Clockwork Gnome.
It's great in non-combo metas, I will say that.
That is true. None of these save you against combos, right? Yeah. Like, the Maze of Ith does not help you against a combo in any way. But, like, what land will?
I mean, that actually kind of describes our list, right? If you look at the lower tiers of the list, it's a lot of stuff that can save you in specific, like, good in the early game, not in the late game. Good against creatures, mm-hmm. not against combos. And then at the top of the list, it's the more generic, I guess, like, can deal with a whole bunch of things. Teferi's Protection, counter spells, farewell effects. So I feel like that's probably one of the biggest things in the ranking is just, like, how much can this actually deal with?
All right, Kriven Tomer. Yeah. Above or below Fog, Maze of Ith?
I'd say, Maze of Ith. Okay, below Fog.
I think on average, there are more, situations where, which card type has more things that could save me? So technically, I think there's more Fogs.
I mean, they're both creature type. I mean, they both deal with creatures, right?
Right,
Fog,
right. But
Fog
I'm just
deals
thinking,
with
I'm just thinking,
a huge board of creatures yeah. once. Maze deals with one big creature repeatedly, basically.
Numerous times. But so at this point, there are more Fogs, right? Because, like, we're doing what is able to help us stay alive, right?
Yeah.
So I'm thinking of literally just lands or Fogs, right? And I think there are more Fogs, so technically I'd put it below a Fog.
Also of note is it has to target a creature. So if somebody has like Hexproof or Shroud, if they have a Lightning Greaves on them or whatever, you can't prevent the damage. So that's actually important. Because like
Fog
Lightning
can.
Greaves are pretty. Yeah, but Fog can. So I'm just saying that's a point in favor of Fog is like if you actually need to stop a lethal attack, then Fog is more.
Wait,
consistent.
Does Questing Beast stop Maze of Ith?
Yes.
Because it removes from combat. It doesn't prevent damage.
Oh,
right?
No,
but
you can
Maze
a Beast.
Doesn't need...
But Questing Beast, like Fog, is like very sad against Questing Beast, right?
Yes, Questing Beast wrecks Fog.
Yeah, but who plays Questing Beast in command?
I mean, you jest, but I'm like, I need to put Skullcrack in my
God.
Deck.
You might have to start because of the wondering,
yeah.
There are lots of games, like... A lot of these cards, there are decks that cannot win against. Like, if you have a Maze of Ith plus the land that removes Hexproof, a Voltron deck can't kill you. If you have Constant Mists with enough lands, like, creature decks cannot get through to you unless they're running Counterspell. So there are a lot of these cards that just decks cannot beat whatsoever. So, I like those styles. Like, It's insurance, right? It lets you just leave that person alone, and they can wreak havoc on the rest of the board because you're not scared of them whatsoever. Like you're sitting behind Maze of Ith and a Counterspell or something, like you're safe. You don't need to sweep the board and drag out the game. You can let them kill everyone, and then you kill them. So, yeah, that's our defensive tier. Everything's in kind of B because like the situational.
Mm-hmm.
Poor Goat is in C.
Way at the bottom.
And then we have our Beast Within and Counterspell in A, and then Teferi Protection and Wrath in S. That's where we ended up with.
Looks reasonable. I think it looks pretty solid, actually.
I'd put Goat in B, but I think
I'd put Fog in S, but
I mean, sure.
Well, I can't win.
We're just sort of body and mind go here.
S.
What about playing
it's
a
protection.
Deck so bad that
your
no
opponents
one wants
can't
to
attack
you
if you keep milling all their best creatures? Obviously.
Yes. Yeah. All right. So that wraps up the podcast. Thank you, everyone. Let us know if we missed it. Oh, wait. We missed a card.
What did we miss?
We'll just skip it. Life gain. We forgot about life gain. We'll skip it. We'll ask the comments what they think about life game. What do you think about like Sierra Ascendant, Crypt Incursion, Soul Warden, Gnaw to the Bone, I guess, Whip of Erebos?
That'd be B, I guess. Yeah, with propagandas and stuff, because it's like anti-chip damage, I would assume. I don't know.
That literally stops, like helps with chip damage.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's around there.
Let us know in the comments what you think, and we'll see you all back next week.